Good evening, Oakwood. Go ahead, stand up. We're going to sing some praise. Your name, for there's always a way when you lead me. And when life knocks me down, I am not counted out, for you're with me. And you're with me. Even when it feels like the light is fading and I've lost my way, still I'm holding on to the one who's making all things possible. Even when it feels like my heart is breaking, hold on, there is strength, knowing I belong to the one who's making all things possible. Mountains can move. I've seen what you can do in my weakness.
In my weakness.
So my heart will believe. If I wait, I will see my God doing what only He can do. Yeah. Even when it feels like the light is fading and I've lost my way, still I'm holding on to the one who's making all things possible. Even when it feels like my heart is breaking, hold on, there is strength, knowing I belong to the one who's making all things possible. My God is strong and mighty, my God is faithful, my hope is in the Lord, for He is able. My God is strong and mighty, my God is faithful.
Yes, He is.
My hope is in the Lord, for He is able. My God is strong and mighty, my God is faithful. My hope is in the Lord, for He is able. Even when it feels like the light is fading and I've lost my way, still I'm holding on to the one who's making all things possible. Even when it feels like my heart is breaking, hold on, there is strength, knowing I belong to the one who's making all things possible. My God is strong and mighty, my God is faithful, my hope is in the Lord, for He is able. My God is strong and mighty, my God is faithful, my hope is in the Lord, for He is able.
Come on, somebody in here today.
Right. Good evening, everyone. Glad to see you here, and if you're new here at Oakwood, thank you for coming. Our announcements are important to Oakwood. Today, we have a new sermon series, Biblical Parenting begins next weekend, so be looking forward to that and praying for Pastor Frank. A reminder that OBC 301 class will be taught tomorrow from 3 to 7:30, so if you signed up for that, please make sure you're there. If you haven't signed up, I still think you could sign up at the Welcome Center. So that's our third class of our four classes that we teach here at Oakwood. Donations are being accepted for Love in a Box sponsorship through May 1st. Select Give on the website or app and select Missions Fund in the drop box down or donate in the box at the Welcome Center. Also, join the Women's Ministry on Friday, May 20th at 6:30 for packing boxes followed by a viewing of Unplanned. RSV on the website or app. That's a great movie, tough to watch, but a great movie if you haven't seen that. Also, join the men's ministry as we take in a Tigers game and enjoy the home plate pregame show featuring Tigers who will discuss their faith has how their faith has impacted their game. So that's real exciting. For more information and to register, check out the app or the website. The deadline for that is going to be on May 5th, so a lot of stuff, exciting things going on. Also, there's more events in our program, so take a look at that. Almost too many to mention, so if you want to just turn around, tell somebody you love them, and let's get back to worship.
Let love explode and bring the dead to life. A love so bold to see a revolution somehow. Let love explode and bring the dead to life. A love so bold to see a revolution somehow. Now I'm lost in your freedom. This world I'll overcome. My God's not dead, he's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. My God's not dead, he's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion, roaring, he's roaring, he's roaring like a lion. Let hope arise and make the darkness hide. My faith is dead, I need a resurrection somehow. Now I'm lost in your freedom. This world I'll overcome. My God's not dead, he's surely alive. He's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. My God's not dead, he's surely alive, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion, roaring, he's roaring, he's roaring like a lion.
Yes, he is
roaring, he's roaring. Let heaven roar and fire fall. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Heaven roar and fire pour. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Let heaven roar and fire pour. Come shake the ground with the sound of revival. Oh my God, and he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. My God's not dead, he's surely alive. And he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. My God's not dead, he's surely alive. And he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion. My God's not dead, he's surely alive. And he's living on the inside, roaring like a lion, roaring, he's roaring, he's roaring like a lion. He's roaring, he's roaring, he's roaring like a lion.
Yeah, come out. Thank you.
My foes are many, they rise against me, but I will hold my ground. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storm. My help is on the way, my help is on the way. Oh my God, He will not delay. My refuge and strength always. I will not fear, His promise is true.
Yes, it is.
My God will come through always. Surrounding, chaos abounding, my soul will rest in You. I will not fear the war, I will not fear the storms. My help is on the way, my help is on the way.
My eyes up, my head.
help comes from the Lord. I lift my eyes up, my help comes from the Lord. From the Lord.
Oh yeah, somebody out there today. Somebody out there today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I know you know this one. Come on, sing it with me today. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Well, I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. Yes, I do. Tis grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did, oh yeah, the grace appear the hour I first believed. Somebody sing it today. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rained. Oh, unending love, amazing. He's so good, He's so great. The Lord has promised good to me. Yes, He has His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and pour and be as long as this life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rained. Oh, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me. And like a flood, and like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace, amazing grace. Listen with your heart today. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine, but God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine. Somebody proclaim it, that You are
God, we thank you so much for today and just to be able to sing your praise and to be able to worship you. And God, I have fun getting up on this drum set and I have fun being able to worship you with different talents across this room. We have so many people and so many lives, God, that you have changed. It ain't just my story. It ain't just the people in front of me or the people in this congregation. It's your story, Lord, that you shine through us. We are a vessel, Father. And we ask that you would continue using us to grow this church, and not just Oakwood, to grow the church. That's what we ask, to further your kingdom, Lord, not to further ours, but to further your kingdom in this house today, in this church today, in our lives today. We ask that you would just move in a mighty way, Father. We love you so much. We proclaim the name of Jesus above every name in this room today. And everybody in this room said amen to that. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. This is where our ushers come forth. We're going to take our offering. If you're new with us today, don't you feel obligated to give, but this is something we do here at Oakwood, and we love you so much. And as our pastor comes to speak, let's ready our hearts for his anointed words today.
How many of you ever watched Alice in Wonderland? Okay, do you remember that? Remember the Cheshire Cat? I'm not a world-famous cat lover. Alice and the cat were having a conversation. They were going back and forth and talking about some important things, that one of the things fits into what we're dealing with. And she looked at the cat and she said, "Would you please tell me which way I ought to go from here?" And he looked on her and he said, "That depends a good deal on which and where you want to go." She said, "I don't much care where." He looked at her and said, "Then it doesn't matter which way you go." And that's where multiple individuals live in our society. Me sitting and looking at you and talking about during this whole series about his counsel and wanting to get that, I believe with all of my heart that his counsel is important in every single one of our lives, in whatever junction we're in life, wherever we're at, whether we're raising little people, whether we're in the middle of them leaving our homes, whether we've got grandbabies, whether we're at the end of our own lives, His counsel is important in our world. I have been married to the same lady for just a little bit shy now of 40 years. And in 40 years of marriage, I have found that his counsel is powerful and important. I was in this discussion the other day with a guy that was not a Christian. He wasn't a believer. And he's in that whole struggle of, I just have a hard time with everything you're saying because I don't come from that perspective. And by the time we were finished talking, the bedrock of what he thought he believed had been shaken. Because I'm one of those people that believes in stopping and asking some questions that our society doesn't ask anymore. I deal nonstop every day with young people. I told a gentleman that I was talking with the other day, I think I spend somewhere in the neighborhood of 30 to 40 hours counseling with individuals. The counseling that I used to do 25 years ago was one form of counseling. Just please understand, no disrespect to anyone whatsoever. What I have learned is a majority of the individuals that I counsel now between 16 and 36 haven't even been able to formulate the questions of what's going on inside of me. They have spent so much time having it slammed down their throats that life is all about a party and you're supposed to be happy and you're supposed to be having a good time. And so when they're partying and they're supposedly happy and supposedly having a good time, and then they're miserable, or they're walking around and watching one storyline after another of one 15-year-old or 18-year-old or 24-year-old that is now dead, real change becomes profound. I think I formed a lack of tolerance for just letting things go on a long time ago. So my wife and I, in the 40 years of being married, have multiple discussions about how do we fix this? How do we adjust it? So in your life, as I've gone through this series, there's things that we've talked about that have clicked in your head that you've gone, yo, yes, got it. I want to be able to do that. Okay. So this tonight is taking the first step. And if I could just say three things real quick before I hit the verse. The smallest step that you can take in the right direction can end in the biggest way. It's just getting you to do it. How many of you in this room will not put sugar in your body? How many of you are a non-sugar person? You're just not eating it. Okay, two individuals. Okay, good. How many of you in this room will not put things like saccharin or aspartame or something like that in your body? How many of you are like that? Wow, that's a really cool group. I had somebody send me a picture one time. It was a picture of a sucker laying on the ground. And it showed a line of ants coming up to the sucker. And then they went around the sucker and they went on. And they wouldn't eat the sucker. And so I found out that the sucker was full of a fake chemical that I ingested every single day of my life. I was being kidded one time about the amount of sweet and low, the little pink packets that I put in things. And Mrs. Radcliffe, I think, is already gone, but there are a few friends in here that will verify this for you, that I drink an average of somewhere between 12 to 15 cups of coffee a day. And if you take 12 to 15 cups of coffee and put 3 bags of sweet and low in each cup, and then I drink iced tea, and there's usually 5 or 6 bags in each glass of iced tea, and then I drink Diet Dr. Pepper, which the rats won't even drink that. And so as I was looking at that picture, the animal kingdom won't deal with that. And I'm an individual of extremes. I used to weigh 400 pounds for a reason, and I supposedly switched gears, but in all reality, I really wasn't switching gears. So this birthday coming up will now be 6 years ago that I walked in the kitchen and I looked at my wife and I said, that's it, I'm done, I'm finished, I will not touch sweet and low again. And so when this birthday gets here, I've not touched it for 6 solid years. Do I feel any differences in my health? No. Can I make any claims? No. I can just say this. The thing that my wife was worried about, me getting cancer from Sweet and Low, I tried to explain her that for me to get the equivalency of what they give to a lab rat, which means I would have to drink 10,000 cans of pop a day that had that in it, it doesn't make me feel one bit better. It makes her feel way better. Which you guys understand, living in marriage, making the wife feel way better usually helps in life. So just one tiny step, just to go, okay, look, I'm not changing in this area, and I'm not changing in this area, and I'm not changing in that area, but I'm going to give up this one thing. That's just one step. Sometimes the steps that God looks at us and says, I want you to take, means you have to step out of what your security is. And it will sound really dippy to you, but how many of you in this room are coffee drinkers? What would happen to you in the morning if you didn't have your cup of coffee? How many of you, before the day is over, I'd be over at the prison trying to pay your bail to get you out? Okay. I'm one of those people that's not addicted to coffee, and you go, wait, you have how much coffee? You're not addicted to it? I'm also an individual that fasts, which means I go without food and stuff for a long period of time. It's just water, and I know what withdrawals are from caffeine, and I know what withdrawals are from sugar. And it'll sound really weird to you, but I'm not addicted to caffeine. I'm addicted to the security that it causes in my body. And so you'll understand that. That just simply means you pour the coffee, you put it in, you put it to your mouth, and you go, and your body goes, and I feel good. Now, I understand that you're sitting here right now going, you need help. I got help a long time ago. His name was Jesus. But can I ask you a question that I think is important? If you had one shot at changing your whole life and making everything completely different, and that one shot came up, would you capture it or would you let it slip by? What kind of person are you? Because, see, I'm one of those individuals that believes that church was designed by God to change our lives. I don't believe that church was designed to be therapeutic. A lot of churches in our culture that we call the woke movement, that's what they're doing with church. They're trying to turn it into a big therapy session. Everyone that's worked with children in this room, would you please say amen? Amen. You know, the most children don't need to be talked to. I'm getting ready to do a series on parenting. You're going to have fun with that. A whole lot of little kids out there just need their butt busted. And I'm not talking about child abuse. I'm talking about we've picked up stuff and turned it in the wrong direction. And we are producing insanity. All of my life I've lived in a world of, if you do something, there should be certain results. If there's not certain results, something's wrong. And when someone came in a whole bunch of years ago and said, you need to do this with children and this with children, someone should have gone down the road and said, we need to see what the results of all that stuff we did was. Does that make sense? The whole group that took over our education system in the United States of America, since the day they took it over till today, they have completely 100% screwed up our education system. Devastated it. And yet every year they want more money. I'm an individual that lives in a world of, time out. How many times have we been asked in the state of Michigan to pay more taxes to get our highways fixed? And you can literally close your eyes and know when you leave Ohio and drive into Michigan, amen? You go from to, and that's the highway, not a country road. So if you said to God, I want my life to be different and I want it to change, I believe since God is real, God looks at you and says, I want to change your life. I just think that there's this path I want you to walk that will bring that about. That path. So humble yourselves under the mighty power of God. And at the right time, he'll lift you up in honor. Give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares about you. It is the most finite, pointed thing in the Christian world. All of you are big boys and big girls. You learned a long time ago, worrying doesn't fix anything. How many of you have learned that? So why do we keep beating that up? Everyone in this room that's had the pleasure of taking a teenager through the driver's course and learning everything about driving and doing all the things that you had to do, and then you had to stand there in the front yard and hand the kid your keys and watch them get in the car and drive off by themselves. And your insides went because you wanted to be in the vehicle driving to protect them like they were when they were little bitty babies in car seats. But we have to grow up and let them go. You go, they're going to get in a wreck. Just for a little thing here, everyone in this room that's raised a kid that started driving, it's been in a wreck already, would you please raise your hand? Wow. So it's not they might get in a wreck, it's what? Yeah. I raised five. Between the five, there's been 9 car wrecks. Isn't it amazing when you raise kids, 9 car wrecks? It was never their fault. It was always someone else's fault. And so every one of you that are raising kids that are not driving yet, there's a car wreck in your future. So don't buy nice cars for them. Get the worst junker you can get and say, here, drive this. After they've smashed the daylights out of that and have all that out of their system, then help them get a nicer car. That was free advice. God looks at me and says, Frank, humble yourself. Under God's power. And even though none of this makes sense to you and it's all radically crazy, all of this counsel that he says, at the right time he will lift you up in honor. So while you're going through every bit of that, give all your worries and your cares to God. Take that kid that's climbing into the car to drive off on the thing and say, Father, I can't be there, but you can be. You can drive in the vehicle. You can be behind them. You can be with my daughter. When that young boy goes to get appropriate and puts his arm around him improperly, the angel in the back seat can go, psh! I can't be there, but you can. I can't take care of my wife and everything that goes on while she's out doing the things that she's doing. I can't control any of this, but I have a God who looks at me and says he loves me, and since he loves me and he cares for me, he can do this. So once I have gotten his counsel, once he has spoken to me, where do I go? And I called this next part in your notes, if you have them with you, called the dream. And I thought I'd sit down and use a story that's really popular in Scripture. And so you can understand this story and what is all behind it. Let me give you the back part of it. God looked at his people and said, I want you to obey me. I want you to worship me. And they chose no. So God allowed the Babylonian kingdom to come in to attack them, to destroy them, to take everything that mattered to them and wipe it out, to burn most of their city to the ground, to tear their temple apart, and then to carry them into captivity. And they were just stubborn enough. I say this with due respect. How many of you in this room would classify yourself as a stubborn individual? Cool. Me too. Their stubbornness was such that they sat in captivity for 140 years before they got it. And finally, after 140 years, some of them went, this didn't work. Maybe we can do it his way. And so a part of them with Zerubbabel went back to the homeland. They were heartbroken. They were discouraged. They were humiliated. They had to stand there amongst what was left of their homes and the wall of Jerusalem and the temple. And in the middle of all the pain and all the stuff that was going on, they started trying to build. This is really, really, really key. Everyone in this room that's over 50, please say amen. Life going by fast for you? You believe your kids are the age they are and all that stuff already? I ask that question for this reason. I don't remember being born. My mother told me about it. I do remember, I was just talking to some of our church members back then, I remember I was the perfect child. My mother said I was. There was none others like me until I was 21. She said at 21 I became a demon-possessed child. What really happened was, is I loved my mom, but my mom couldn't let go of being a parent, and I was ready to be let go of as a young man, so we started a war. It wasn't anything stupid. I didn't do drugs or all the other craziness that went on. I just acted out. I got married to a wonderful lady, had 5 kids. Didn't realize that when you have a child, you put it in the crib at night and you shut the door, and the next day when you go back and open the door, its feet are now hanging out of the crib. I didn't know that the next night when you put it into a regular bed that you'd open the door and their feet would be out of that, and they'd be moving out of your house and getting married to some no-good, low-life jerk. And I didn't realize before I knew it was going down, we were going to have grandbabies running all over the place. And I also didn't realize that somewhere in there, I was going to have to start putting up with the old people jokes in church because I was now classified as one of them. And I want to know how in the blue blazes I got from there to here so stinking fast. And with that in mind, I am a creature that was created to not just live here on earth. I was created and made to live in the heavenlies. And I am going to never not quit living. And I am going to live for eternity. And so this little time that I get to spend on this earth, he speaks and he says things. And he says things to us, and he has tried to speak to his people, and he did his best to speak to them. And as I have gone from here to here to here to here, he has spoken to me many times. And I, just like them, have had multiple times that I didn't listen. So with everything that they were going through, and they go back home and things aren't going well, discouragement hits even more because a whole bunch of people went against them trying to build what they were doing. Back in Babylon, Nehemiah started getting an itch. I've talked about this for the last couple of weeks. This still small voice started speaking inside of him. And as that voice kept speaking and kept saying things, he began to realize that God was speaking to him. And God was trying to say to him, there's something I want you to do. I want you to go to another city. I want you to leave where you are. I want you to leave where you've been almost every ounce of everything that you know. I want you to walk away from it, and I want you to go build the walls around the city that your whole family came from. That became the dream. And somewhere in the dream, we have to do something called examine the issue. And so one day while Nehemiah was doing his job that he ever did, and if you don't know what a cupbearer is, I'll explain that to you in a moment, he was doing the job of a cupbearer. Doing his job, some of the friends that he had known that had gone back and forth from Babylon to Jeremiah came walking in, and he said, how are things going there? I've heard things are going bad. I've heard things have slowed down. I heard things are not going well. And they looked at him and said, things are not going well for those who have returned to the province of Judah. They're in great trouble and they're in disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem has been torn down and the gates have been destroyed by fire. Nehemiah's heart began to ache. I'm sorry. I have to do this so you understand it. You ever looked into the face of a drug addict? You ever looked into the face of an individual that doesn't know how to get by one day without drinking a fifth of whiskey? You ever see brokenness? See, I don't know how many of you church people have ever had to sit at a table respectfully like I have and look into the face of an individual with a revolver that just wants to pick it up and put it in their mouth and end their life. I've been there for them jumping off the buildings. But see, since a bunch of you don't understand that world, I'll take it to the next world. You ever been so depressed you can't think straight? You ever been so tired of failure and messing up and flubbing and things are not going like you want them to go? And then something happens and something changes. Every once in a while, someone in the church will talk to me because I spent a lifetime struggling with depression. I learned the God who knows how to fix it. In learning who can fix it, I sit across tables and look into the face of people that are struggling with it, and everything inside of me wants to go, just do this and do this, because it's the path I walked. I'm sorry, I'll take it even further home. I'm 190. I was 400. Do you know the depression you live in when you look in the mirror and you don't like what you see? And you make all the jokes and you say all the things before other people say them? And then one day you change. They told me this coming May, I had 5 years to live. That was 18 years ago. I'm still being a pain in the butt for this many years. Why? I found what worked. You ever find what works and you just want to look at someone else and go, this is what you do! Some of you in here don't live in the world I do. I annoyed some police officers one time. I walked into a room where the guy that I knew was talking about committing suicide, and he had a revolver laying there, and I walked over and picked up the revolver and checked it all out, made sure that there was only one bullet in it, and I laid it back on the table, and I looked at him and said, would you quit wasting everybody's time and get it over with, please? The police officers did not like that. And so I kept nudging it toward him, saying, get it done. I have things to do. If we get it done today, I can do the funeral on Tuesday and I'll have you out of the way. You go, that's demented. He's still alive today. He has a wife that he adores. He has grandbabies now. And we now joke about it. He wanted to know one time why I made sure there was only one bullet in the gun. And I said, so you wouldn't use one on me and then deal with you. So when I look at you and I say, examine the issue. Your dream might be losing weight. You look at that lady that used to weigh 200 pounds and now she's 125 and she's gone from being a size 11, 12, or 80 down to a size 4. And you're torn between loving her or hating her guts. You might be one of those individuals that was trapped in drugs and alcohol and now you're not like that anymore. You don't live under that embarrassment. You don't live under that shame. You finally got help. You got freedom. You know how you think. You know what you do, and you're not trapped anymore. And you look at someone else that is, and you're like, God, what can I do? How can I help them? You listen to individuals that, I'd like to follow God. I'd like to be able to live for the Lord. I'd like to be able to sit and say, I know God, and I understand God, and I get it. That my prayer life is what it's supposed to be. That when I pray, it doesn't feel like it's stopping at the ceiling. I'm able to read God's word. I'm able to understand that it means something. My religion's not fake. And if you go, well, I'm semi in there someplace. Everyone in this room that believes in God, would you please say amen? So when I say point number two, take it to God. How many of you understand that God has real big shoulders? Well, I heard one good amen. How many of you in this room know that God has really big shoulders? So are you allowed to tell God how ticked off you are? How many of you understand you can do that? How many of you understand that you can tell God, I've just about had enough? And God doesn't go, oh, we're going to curse you with flies and gnats. You know, you are allowed to be aggravated and frustrated. You are allowed to say to God, I don't get it. Nehemiah did. Nehemiah said, God, the wall's got to be built. If they don't build the wall, they can't finish the temple. They can't even build their homes. And God, I am the least likely guy to do it. I'm a cupbearer. And a few of you in this room might go, well, that cupbearer, that's an easy job. How many of you understand the job of a cupbearer with a king? Okay, good. This was a cupbearer. They came in with a tray with the wine on it for the king. The cupbearer stood beside the throne. When they came by with the wine, he reached over as the cupbearer, took the wine, took a sip, and then stood there. And the king waited, and everyone waited. And when the time had passed for what they knew poisons would do to you, he'd put it back and the king was allowed to drink it. You can understand that the cupbearer's retirement program wasn't very nice, okay? Because multiple people wanted to kill the king, and so multiple cupbearers lost their life. It was looked at as a prestigious role because you knew that you were running the risk of sacrificing your life for the king. That's what Nehemiah did for a job. And he said, God, there's this burn and this ache inside of me that wants to go build a wall, and I don't know how to build a wall. I have no knowledge of how to do that. And one of the things we miss is God doesn't ever look at us and say, I have a job to do, and so I'm calling the most qualified person to do it. God always says, I'm calling the person with the biggest heart to do it. I don't care what your qualifications are. I don't care what ability you have. I drive a Ford F-150 2008, and the brakes have gone bad. Everyone know what a vehicle sounds like when the brakes go bad? The squeak, 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 squeak. Do you know how many people I'm driving through the community roll their window down and go, hey, you know your brakes are bad? You would like to know what I always yell back at them? No, I'm not telling you. It's nothing mean. I just have fun. You go, why don't you get it fixed? Anyway, back to the sermon. Have you ever sat with God and said to God, I don't know what I'm doing, and I don't know how to do it, so would you show me how? Nehemiah said, oh Lord, please hear my prayer. Listen to the prayers of those who delight in honoring you. Please grant me success today by making the king favorable to me. Put it into his heart to be kind to me. Please, God. It's just like the world I live in of saying, Father, and maybe you do, Father, you got me off of this, or you got me out of this, particularly I don't do this anymore. And Father, I have an ache and a burden for helping people to do the same thing I did, but I have no idea what I'm doing. Would you show me how to do it? Father, I have a burden for telling people about you. In the society we used to live in, it used to be pretty easy to talk about you. And now it's gotten scary. What do I say? What do I do? And I'm not making that up. My wife, how many of you read books super fast? How many fast readers do we have in this room? Okay, I read 800 words per minute, okay? I'm a speed reader. Okay, most of you read down a little bit lower. I read The Lord of the Rings plus The Hobbit, four books. I read those in about 5 days. Okay, if my wife reads them, that's about a 4-month to 5-month process, okay? So how many of you have ever gone to the Ark down in Kentucky? How many of you have ever been there before? The Creation Museum, you ever been there before? You do realize it's nothing but reading, right? If you have children under 11, don't take them there, okay? Because you'll be trying to pull children out of cages where the animals supposedly were and all these other insane things, because it's just all reading. So Robin and I would walk into a room that was about 30 by 40, and Robin would walk up to the first thing and start reading. And when she'd take the step to go to the second thing, I had already read the whole room. And so by the time she'd gone to the third thing, I'd read the room again four times. I'm into the next room, reading the next room, coming back to find her. And she's like, what are you doing? I lied. I didn't want her to feel bad. I had to go to the potty. You go, excuse me, time out. What does that have to do with anything? Me going, because if I get bored, I start praying. Nia, like me, I get bored, I start praying. Okay, I don't look through stupidity. I just get bored, I start praying. I found that's a greater thing to do when you're bored. So I would get bored and start praying. And I said, God, people have gotten really weird. It used to be when you shared your faith with people, it was pretty simplistic. Jesus died, he was buried, he rose again. Would you like to ask him into your life? They said yes or no. God, it's not like that anymore. It's like witnessing to people in a foreign country. What do I do? That discussion was all while she was on the fourth thing that she was reading. And by the way, don't think for 1 ounce I'm belittling my wife. Robin, all the way through now, almost done with her doctorate degree, has never made anything less than an A, so the woman's brilliant, okay? It's just, we read at a different rate. So I was walking through this other room, and I could see her back here somewhere. And I had just prayed that, and I walked into this room, and there was this book there, which when you show me a book, everybody knows what happens when I see a book. Okay, good. And I saw this book, and I picked up this book, and I went, okay, God, what's this about? And I went through I got to the third page, and it was like the book jumped up and went, eek! And I just stood there going, and I don't think I moved for a while, because when Robin walked in the room, I was standing there with tears rolling down my face, and she's like, you okay? And he answered me that fast. See, I believe that if I say to a holy God, I'm lost, and I don't know what to do, would you guide me and direct me? And he speaks. And sometimes it's quiet in my heart, and sometimes it's real loud, and sometimes it's some dippy little kid that says something, and sometimes, not a lot, but sometimes it's my wife. I don't want that breaking out amongst the men in the church, okay? Sometimes it's my wife. And every once in a while, it's a book. And sometimes it's a song that they sing. And sometimes it's my stupid dog. You go, how's it your dog? The other day, Robin has a foo-foo dog. Everybody know what a foo-foo dog is? It's something smaller than a football, so it doesn't really count as a dog. Robin has a foo-foo dog. And it needed to go to the vet to be checked to make sure it was okay from a little surgery that it had. And I was sitting reading, and I was reading this book for the 12th time, and my brain kind of got a little away, and I heard God say, set your alarm so you don't go to sleep and be late for getting Robin's foo-foo dog over there, because she'll kill you. And I didn't. So I went to sleep on page 56. And then my phone rang, and it was one of those, you know, things that says probably some idiot in some other country is calling you, selling you insurance. And I answered, and all I could hear was 1,000 people talking, so I hung up. And then I looked at the clock. You ever seen a man go into fast motion so his wife doesn't kill him? So me and Fufu Dog was running through the house, out the door, into the van. Fufu Dog wasn't happy. We got all the way, we got halfway there. There's a reason for the story. I'm not being stupid. We got halfway there. And she was crying. And I reached over and patted her on the back. And I started to say something. And I heard him say, "Frank, if I worry about making sure you get a phone call to wake you up to go take care of Fufu Dog, do you think I can miss the issues that you're concerned about in your life?" And I said, "No, sir. I think you love me that much. Do you hear that? Please don't walk out of here not hearing that. He loves you and he adores you. Slow down, be quiet, and listen. And sometimes he'll speak to you through your Fufu Dog. He does not speak through cats, that's demonic. Number three. This is important. I wrap this up as I close tonight. Rest of them kind of go. I just want you to start. So number three, you don't have to have the faith to finish. You just have to have the faith to start. So he, Nehemiah, goes to the king and he looks at him and he says, I don't know what to do. King looks at him and says, "Son, you look like you're about ready to cry. You usually don't look that in front. What's going on?" And he says, "My people, they're in distress. The wall's not being built. And before it was all done, God answered everything." Had he not looked at the king and asked the question, it would have never happened. You guys understand that, right? It was all doing something that's really hard on every single one of us. It's making ourselves start. That's where the faith is. It's not in finishing, it's in starting. He went from the king to people in Jerusalem, and he stood there and looked at them. And they're explaining to him what's going on, and he says to them, "You know very well what trouble we're all in. Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been destroyed by fire. Let's rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. Let's end this disgrace. I told him about how gracious the hand of God had been on me and about my conversation with the king. And they replied, let's do it. Let's get to work." And you can picture all the guys that knew what they were doing walking away from going, "What are we listening to a cupbearer for? He doesn't have any idea what he's doing. Let's go get Zerubbabel. Because he knows what he's doing. And let's get motivated off his heart." So please hear me as I pull this down so you can go, "I got that." There's something that God has spoken to you in the last 3 or 4 weeks, and you want to move on that. Whether it's being proficient in studying God's word, whether it's helping a group of people, whether it's just getting your life back together, you have to have faith to start. And number four, you have to start small. I love Zechariah when he talked about Zerubbabel. He said, "Do not despise these small beginnings, for the Lord rejoices to see the work begin, to see the plumb line in Zerubbabel's hand." God was thrilled just to see the plumb line in his hand. Just thrilled at the beginning. The opportunity of being able to build and do. He dared to dream. Zerubbabel got caught in all the hard stuff. 16 years of not being able to do anything because people were fighting with him. Haggai came in and said, guys, get busy. And they made all their excuses. And he said, you got time to build your house. You don't have time to build the walls or to build the temple. Just start small. Are there any of you in this room, and I'm sorry, it's a really dumb story, but are there any in this room that love golf? How many golfers do we have? How many of you know the history of how it came to the United States of America? How many of you know the first president to ever see it done? A Scottishman walked out in front of Ulysses S. Grant and put a ball down on a tee. And President Grant stood over there seeing this new sport demonstrated. The Scottishman leaned back and went, ooh, and completely missed the ball and covered President Grant in dirt so that his assistants were reaching up and trying to pull it out of his beard. And President Grant stood there very patient with his arms crossed. The Scottishman apologized profusely, and he said in his heart, he went, if this doesn't go good, he's not going to sanction us doing the stuff that we're supposed to do. So he leaned back and took a second swing and missed again. Ulysses S. Grant, president, watched him swing six times and missed every single time. And when he was done missing for the sixth time and bowed his head in shame, Ulysses S. Grant looked at him and said, I understand there's a whole lot of exercise going on with this. That looks good, but I don't see the point of the ball. Now, how many of you understand that from that humble beginning that golf has grown into something that's mega? Guys, have the guts to go for your dreams. The worst you can do is screw up. The worst you can do is fail. The worst you could do is stand in front of Biden and miss it again and again, and Biden wouldn't even know you missed it. You can quote me on that, okay? Just start small. Start. Number five, take the next step. Just go for it. And this is not a motivational speech. I'm talking about your Christian life. I'm talking about what you do in church. I'm talking about even the company that you're trying to build. Just take the next step, because there's a whole world, respectfully, sorry, there's a whole world of people out there that are losers that will tell you why you can't do it. There's a whole group of people out there that will tell you where you're going to fail and where you're going to mess up and why you're not going to be any good. There's a whole group of people that will say to you, I've tried it before. I tried following God. It didn't work. Nehemiah was doing everything that he was doing, and Sanballat, Tobiah, and Geshem the Arab heard of the plans, and they scoffed contemptuously. They wanted to know what he was doing. Are you rebelling against the king? Because they had no idea that the king had given permission. And Nehemiah said something in front of them that was profound. So everybody please listen, okay? Nehemiah looked at them and said, I can do anything if the God of heaven helps me succeed. You guys do realize that the only reason why most of us as human beings never make it, never succeed, and never get to do the things that we want to do in life is because we never start, because we're so stinking worried about failing. And the worst you can do is lose everything you've got and start over. The worst you can do is make a complete idiot of yourself. How many of you have ever made a complete idiot out of yourself? My mother went on to be one of the finest teachers of teaching her faith that I'd ever met. She could witness to people. It was phenomenal. My mother's first class she ever taught was with a group of third grade girls that had been in church all their little lives. And she looked at them and asked them to take their Bibles and turn to the book of Job. And they laughed their little heads off at her. And a few of you sitting in this room right now are going, I don't get it. What's funny? Because every time you read J-O-B in the Bible, you say Job. And no one's ever told you it's Job. Is it okay to make those kind of mistakes? I have a friend right now that is one of the most awesome scholars in Scripture. It's unreal. I love listening to him talk. His first time in church, the pastor in the pulpit said, turn to the book of John. And he spent 10 minutes trying to figure out why sitting in the pew, there was no book with the name John written on the book. And so when the pastor visited his house, he said, you know, you were short on some books of John in the pews when I was there. The deacon that was with him about lost it. And then got in his car that night and looked over and said, that was the most awesome thing I've ever watched in my life. He said, it's okay to be a beginner, isn't it? And that guy is now a scholar in Scripture that's unreal. St. Francis of Assisi said, start doing what's necessary, then what's possible. Then suddenly you'll do the impossible. Just start. You're going to get fought against. I do regularly. Do it anyway. It's going to be hard. Do it anyway. People are going to cause you problems. They're going to laugh at you. They're going to make fun of you. Do it anyway. There's always someone that's going to be cynical, critical, a smart aleck, someone out there that even right now, looking through what I just said, is going to look St. Francis of Assisi and is going to get their phone out, look up St. Francis of Assisi and go, did he ever say, start doing what's necessary, then what's impossible, then suddenly you're doing the impossible, and they're going to go, no, he never said that. And their critical spirit is the individuals out there that will be in your face nonstop telling you why you can't make it. Do it anyway. Amen. And my last thing, it's really important. Everyone in this room that's in love with each other and you're married, would you please say amen? Do you still like to kiss them? Don't get romantic sitting down here now, right now, Jennifer. Take your arm off her, you hussy. This is church. New people are sitting here watching this. Ish. I love you too. Do you guys understand that the problem with starting in life is not feeling like starting? Do you understand that? That's always the war. Because what we do as humans, where God said to be obedient, we attach feelings to it. We attach, I'm supposed to do something, and I don't feel like doing it. I get up in the morning and have to take two dogs out to the bathroom. Half the time, I'm standing outside watching the two dogs go to the bathroom while I'm going, can we get on with it? I'd like to be able to go to the bathroom. I live a world around you got to come home and let the dog out. How many of you understand that dogs have to go out in a cycle? They go out during certain times of day and you have to keep letting them out? And it never goes away till they die. How many of you are grateful that dogs have short life things? Sorry, another sermon. That's okay. Cats just stink up a box and ruin the house, so that's another sermon. So my point that's really profound, do something when you feel nothing. And so you'll understand the story that I started with so I can close. It's when you look at mama or hubby and you go, no, I haven't kissed them in about 3 years, and if they do kiss me, I'm going to knock the snot right out of them. And then one day you're sitting there with God working through your heart and you realize that you're supposed to be a loving, caring individual to your mate. And you look at someone like me and say, how do I start over loving them like I'm supposed to? And my answer to you is, just do it. You go, I don't feel like doing it. I didn't ask you. One of the men in our church is 82 years old one time. I told him, he goes, I've not kissed my wife in 5 years. I said, go home, walk in the kitchen, and when she's making your breakfast, walk up and sniff her ear, and then grab her from the stove and kiss her passionately. Do you know what she did to him? She hit him with the pan that the eggs were in. And then they both sat in my office, and she looked at me, and she went, did you tell him to do that? I went, yes, ma'am. You know what she said? And she goes, thank you, Pastor. Just do it. Obedience always brings about God working in what you're doing, and the feelings will come along next. If you wait for the feelings to do what you're supposed to do, they'll never come. It doesn't work like that. God works through your spirit, which is at the core of you, and your soul is next. Obedience deals with the spirit. It affects the soul. The soul is your mind, your emotions, and your will. That's where the feelings are. Do what you're supposed to do first. It will affect the soul. Does it make sense to everyone? It doesn't work in the reverse. Would you bow your head and close your eyes with me, please? God started me and my personal life down a path a long time ago of wanting to live a Christian life of being obedient. It affected my life like crazy. I have multiple people that say to me, I've never been able to sense the realness of God. It's there. It's just stopping and waiting and listening and saying, God, work in my life. It's daring to say, would you reveal yourself to me? Would you show me who you are? I was a young man when I accepted the fact that my God created this universe and that He made me. And if He knew me and He wired me and He put me together and He said to me, Frank, you're a sinner. You've done things wrong, and that sin needs to be cleaned and purged and changed, and you need to be made right with me. And so I died for you so you could be made right. And all I need you to do is accept it. And as a young man, I said, God, I accept that. I prayed and said, Father, would you come into my life and change my life? And He changed me forever. So maybe you're here tonight and you've listened to everything I've said. And there's a part of you that says you need God in your life. And if that's you tonight, I challenge you, not worrying about what anyone else is doing in this room, just between you and God and me. If there's a part of you that says, I need God, and I accept who I am and what I am and that He died for me, then right where you're sitting right now, inside, just pray this prayer. Inside, just say, Dear Lord, I believe you're real. I believe you're there. I believe you died for me. I believe you were buried and rose again. Would you come into my life and save me and change me? Thank you, Lord, for changing my life permanently. You're not worried about what another person does in this room. If you prayed that prayer, everyone's heads bowed, everyone's eyes closed, but if you prayed that prayer and you meant business with it, he said in his word, God's word, the Bible, that he would save you and change you permanently. And not worried about what anyone else is doing in this room, but if you prayed that prayer and you meant business with it, would you just look up here at me? And don't worry about what another person does between you, me, and God. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that so much. Between you, me, and him, from the bottom of my heart, thanks. Father, work in our lives. Help us to grow. Help us to follow you. Help us to change and be what you've called us to be. And Master, each one of us have a dream that you've put inside of us, a burden to serve you and something to do with our lives. Help us, guide us, direct us, and challenge us to listen to your voice as you guide us and direct us as we seek your counsel. We ask this in your holy name, Father. Amen. Amen. Most of you guys know how the service always ends. We ask the band to come back and do what? Would any of you like to volunteer to play instruments for us tonight? Does everyone know where everyone is tonight? A few of you going, where is everybody tonight? Everybody know where everybody is? This is the start of softball season. Oakwood never loses. We have two teams we beat. And I always tell them, if you don't beat them, don't come back to church. One's the Mormon church. And I'm not going to tell you who the other one is. But they know. But they're out representing you guys tonight. They're having fun and they're playing. And they're... I love the gang that goes over to watch them. We have an energetic group of people. So if you're wondering where a bunch of them are, that's where they are. They'll all be here at church tomorrow. But I love you. And if you're new with us, it was an honor having you tonight. Let's all stand together, turn around, shake somebody's hand, tell them it was a pleasure to get to know them, and you are dismissed.